Let's start 150 years ago with three poets who invite us to consider the humanity, the individuality of a situation, who are sensationally idiosyncratic, who manifest an Islam and a Kurdish identity that bucks stereotype and excites further study. Mahwi. In the great tradition of Sufi poetry that conflates the divine with the beloved, the tradition that Rumi and Hafiz made famous in the West, he writes, "Holding sugar, savoring of salt, any way it tasted, I would say, the blossom, new and opening, is that mouth, those lips. The garden and its traces have vanished. Only a handful of twigs remains. Even the city of non-existence is no place to become wild." Shehraza, writing in the same tradition but also developing that tradition, brings in curse poetry. He brings in, as one of my students says, only bad words. "Delicate and soft and silky as precious gold, pulvinate and spherical, a planet on its axis, white and soft and split like snow torn by a saw. Forget all this, he had one sweet ass." Jamil al-Zahawi also mixes diction, but a different kind of diction. He's mixing in scientific diction from the scientific method into the poetic tradition. Incidentally, he was fired from his job at the university because of his views on women, science, and Islam. He writes, "I am not for those who hold that religion stands up from God's inspiration, sent down to prophets, but I hold religions are creatively made by wise men in possession of their minds. Nor am I for those who live on the illusion that the soul will ascend to heaven. The earth swims in space, and what is heaven if not that space? Life is accumulation, and death merely dispersion, each separate existence only a change in form. And I am not for those who give great favor to men and not women. But the earth revolved until those and this one became confused." So 150 years later, we see exactly the same kinds of confusion haunting exactly the same region. And I was introduced to these poets by my students. The first translation workshop I ran had seven students with six languages in the room. It was as much an adventure in poetry and translation as in pedagogy. How am I supposed to teach this? The two main things I learned are that you have to make the right mess. That's the only place to start. Things have to get really messy. And the way we do that in translation is we go word for word. It makes no sense at all, but you sort of figure it out. The second step is you begin to balance music and meaning. To give you an example of what I mean here, Abdullah Peshow writes a poem. He's a contemporary Kurdish poet. He writes a poem about a salesman and a donkey, and the salesman is dragging the donkey through the wilderness. You know, it's packed, loaded with things, and they get to a meadow, and he unloads the donkey, and the donkey sort of, my students had a lovely time figuring out the word hee-haw. The donkey sort of runs around and leaps and rubs his back in the grass, and then across the mountains, the salesman hears the noise of a bandit, and he says, "Get up, get up, get up, we gotta go, we gotta go." And the donkey says, "Listen, man, I don't think you understand. Whether it's you or them, I'm still an ass. Pain is pain." And so this is a very, very clever poem. It's all about sort of the punchline at the end, building up to it. But the original has quite a bit of music. It rhymes, it's in couplets. And he also has lots of wordplay, like hee-haw, he has denga-denga, things like that. So you don't want to lose that in the translation. To get that, what you can do is think about this. Salesman can be salesman, or a salesman can be a peddler. A donkey can be an ass, but it can also be a pack mule. Once you have peddler and pack mule, now you have a sonic environment, the alliteration of PP. Now a bag can be a bag, or it can be a saddlebag, or it can be a pack. Now again, peddler, pack mule, pack. Now a donkey can be unburdened, the packs could be taken off, or you could say the donkey became barebacked. Now we've got peddler, pack mule, pack, barebacked. We've got pa, pa, ba, ba, and then the ack, ack, ack. Right? So that's what I mean when I say sort of living up to the sonic texture of the original. The second year we had 15 students, That's the upper photo. We had 15 students over 11 languages in the classroom, and we're now really digging into what it means to be a translator in the region. Really, with the regional body of work, you're not just translating, you're engaging in diplomacy. You're translating a culture for a global community. You're confounding expectations, and you're transgressing borders. These emerging translators are saying the things others fear to say as they breathe new life into these beloved poets. To give you an idea of the political and linguistic complexity of the context, let's look at a map. All right, this is my hand-drawn map. Clearly it's very simplified, but it's to give you a really easy clarity about the region. So you can see we've got Turkey, Iran, Iraq, and Syria. The majority of Kurds live in the outlined blue region, and my university is, our university, is that red star right there. Within Kurdish, you have four different dialects, four main dialects, but other dialects in addition to that, that are so significantly diverged, Hauramans cannot speak to those who speak Sorani. So they function as separate languages within a single poem. If I'm writing 150 years ago, I also have classical versions of all of these languages. And if I'm a Kurd writing 150 years ago, likely I'm using at least three of these languages in a single poem. So imagine the effort to translate a single poem usually requires multiple translators, multiple fluencies. In addition to our work inside the classroom, we're also really expanding to talk to the region. The problem of town and gown is always in existence for universities, but more so when the university's culture is so divergent from the context culture. So American University clearly has an American culture, and the surrounding culture is Arabic and Kurdish. So we've been really bridging, trying to host regional poets at our university. Here, emerging translators take the stage beside poets such as Abdullah Peshow, Sheko Bekas, and Hemin Latif. Additionally, we're reaching out to our global community. As I said at the very beginning, these poets, even 150 years ago, are clearly poets who changed the face of global perceptions of the region. So at the end of each year, I produce an anthology, both in hard copy and in digital. If you go to iTunes and you have an iPad, you can actually download last year's anthology for free. But we've also had lots of support from magazines. Specifically, the Iowa International Writing Program has been very supportive. Their online magazine, 91st Meridian, is contemplating publishing some of these translations right now. The next step for this project is really to think about a comprehensive anthology. It doesn't exist. And specifically, it doesn't exist in English. So biography and addressing how these poems fit into the context of that larger splintered world that you saw on the map. So finally, so what? All of this translation, all of these things inside and outside the classroom, so what? For our students, we've succeeded in bridging the gap between all of the tensions they carry. So each student comes into my classroom with tensions between the East and the West, the North and the South, their home and their academic environment. And this project allows them to tie those two things together, not just for those to be productive tensions, but for them to actually be a gift to others, making them ideal cultural, artistic ambassadors for poems that they've loved for years. It's a gift to me as a poet and a human being. I've discovered poets that have changed my life, that have made me feel like I have kindred spirits in the world. I mean, Sheikh Raza is the Walt Whitman of the Middle East. Thank God, I know he exists now. My life is 1,000% better. And it's a gift to the global community. These poems are poems in which to find challenge, in which to find solace, in which to find a human mind that can excite you once more about the possibilities of being human. So I invite you all to read them, come visit, come to a reading, and thank you for your time.